this sounds intriguing to you in any way, then we invite you to come to this mentoring program where you will be mentored together with your spouse on how to manage your finances together. So I encourage you, sign up for Couples and Money.
See you there.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody.
Welcome. Welcome to Couples and Money. We are so excited to be here and to see all of you. I'm just wondering where you're tuning in from. My name is Wangesh Kanyeki and...
I am Willy Kanyeki. If you could kindly share where you're tuning in from, put it on the chat, and be able to just welcome everyone.
Yeah, and we would like to start with a word of prayer, first of all, if you would prefer us.
So let me pray. Father, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for enabling us to just congregate and share as a community. We pray that you bless our time together and that you would bless each and every person that is joining us. Thank you for, I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, so thank you everybody for taking time to invest in your marriage. Finances, as you have heard, are a leading cause of strife in marriages, leading to separations and divorces. So finances can be a trouble spot. So that's why we do this. So please, let's hear where you're logging in from. If you can put on your chat, we are in Kiambu. It's cold and chilly.
Tuning in from Kiambu County.
Yeah. Representing South Sea, Duncan, we see you right there.
In South Sea, a concrete jungle by any chance?
Moses Maina is from Kitengela and it's sunny, quite the opposite of where we are.
We have neighbors, somebody from Roysambu, karibu sana.
That's Dorcas. Okay, anybody else? Is there anyone from East Africa? Anyone from Uganda? Oh, Caroline is on her way to Kisumu. You're an early bird.
Kisumu, sit. Say hi to the people there.
Joki is in Nairobi industrial area.
When somebody says the industrial area, in Kumanisha Momenda Kazini, people don't live in industrial area. Ama, do you?
Okay.
So somebody tuned in from Athi River, Frankfurt. Wow. Welcome.
Wow, welcome. Comarocs at Sylvester, the slides representing Comaroc. We have somebody from Kiambu, Rebecca.
Wow, Kafaria Castle, Tom and Lorraine.
Okay. Wow. Okay, you must send the pictures. Here.
Nice one. Welcome, guys.
Emmanuel Gashanja is in Westland.
And Tindigua.
We have a neighbor there from Tindigua, Kiambu.
Awesome. So all the way from Eldoret.
Joki's at work already. Okay, all right. Much respect to you.
All right.
So just to introduce, just get us to get to know us a little bit better. Kanyeki, you can say what you do.
Yo, so my name is Willy Kanyeki, and I'm an entrepreneur, business coach with a finance background of 30 years in multinational organizations. And I love to play golf and solve complex puzzles in my free time.
Yeah, he can do a 1,000-piece puzzle, which I don't get it.
And the Rubik Cube.
I've learned how
to solve the Rubik Cube. Yani.
Exactly.
50 years later, that's a journey.
Yeah, so I'm a journalist. I've been in the media and PR industry for the last 15 years. I amplify brands in African region using the right media. So we connect our clients to the right media and then we amplify your story. I've been in the marketing communication practice for the last 30 years and was a stay-home mom for 12 years. Yeah.
Awesome. So today's event is generously sponsored by Couples and Money. And what is Couples and Money?
Well, Couples and Money is a 10-week online course that talks about money, and you get to discuss money matters. In which you actually meet once a week. It's an online course, and you get to do it within a group of 4 to 5 couples just to discuss what you're learning. So there's group learning, and then there's the individualized learning, and then it's online. So you get videos and content that will teach you about money.
Yeah, so the topic, some of the topics you cover as a couple include your money personality, how to defeat debt, creating a family mission, creating an intentional money journey, building passive income, and teaching your kids about money, and so on. There's so many things that are very holistic that you learn about money. And to lead us into this, we have a couple who are joining us. This Rebecca and Simiu Sangura. If you could kindly switch on your video, we would like to welcome, guys. Hi. Good to see you this morning.
Good morning.
Kindly introduce yourselves. Who are you guys? How long have you been married? What do you do?
Good morning, everyone. I'm Rebecca Mwara Sangura. We have been married for the last 20 years. This November, we shall be 20 years.
Wow.
And thank you. I work at Masai Mara University. I lecture there, and I've been lecturing for the last 10 years. And my area of specialization is in international relations.
Awesome.
Good morning.
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 My name is Samuel Sangura Simiu. At times I'm called Muse. And I've been married to this girl for the past 20 years, but I've known her for the past 27 years. And I am a tax consultant by practice. I practice the third permanent thing in life. And I was working in a partnership with some three partners running an audit firm, but I'm on transition into running my own business, doing tax consultancy and bookkeeping.
Wow, well done, Bona Sangura. I can already see creases forming on my wife's face when you mentioned the word tax and bookkeeping. Anyway, well done, good for you guys. So tell us about your journey. When did you do Couples and Money, and how has this changed your life?
Okay, I'll go first. We did Couples and Money in the June-September 2022 cohort. That's to say we were the last class to graduate. And in Couples and Money, this is a holistic money journey, so that you learn about your family of origin, you learn about your money temperament, you get to learn about how you relate with money, you get to learn how to move out of debt, you get to learn how to train children about money. So the main learnings that we've learned from Couples and Money, first was how to make budgets that work, not just making spending plans, but making budgets that work. So a budget we make now helps us to be able to save, so that we can be able to stretch the shilling. Then after doing Couples and Money, we joined an investment class run by a wealth management company called Moran Capital. One of the things that we've learned at Moran Capital is to get to understand our status in life. I just passed the 50-year mark on my last birthday. So we've got to learn that we need to stop collecting and start consolidating. And you see, I come from Bungoma, but I have lived in Kiambu long enough. And on this side of the planet, people talk about Teri. So we had collected so much land around us, which we've had to stop now. We don't want to, if anybody's selling land, please don't approach us, we won't buy. We can only sell you to other people to buy. So we've diversified our portfolio. We noticed we are keeping so much money in the bank that was not helping us. We've been able to move it into investment vehicles that like money market lines. we're considering buying a bond so that we can also be able to have passive income without really to push our money to work for us instead of us working for money. Then the other key learning we've had is teaching our children about money. For us, couples and money has been a very big, big change in our life. Thank you very much, couples and money.
Well done, well done. That's really, really amazing to hear, Bonasimiu. Karibu sana to the fifth floor. Now we can come there and you say it's out. So, those are very good learning points, and it's wonderful to know. Normally, I think in couples and money, we talk about those assets which are not giving you back anything. We call them idle assets. So I think that's what you learned and decided to convert them to something that will start bringing you back some income. Yeah, and so after you did couples and money, you've now decided to become facilitators. Why have you decided to do that?
It was a great honor. In our long marriage, we have served couples. We have served in the couples ministry in our church for the last 20 years. Immediately we got married, we were recruited in the couples ministry. So this for couples and money is by extension, furthering our mission. And we love serving couples, and we are glad we are here with the invitation of couples and money to continue with our service in the kingdom of God, serving couples. And it is our joy to see couples prosper, prosperous marriage and great families. It is also for us where we joined was also to entrench what we learned in class. Just one session was not enough. And I think consecutive trainings will entrench and make it practical for us. What we learned was practical. Now we are taking it to the theoretical bit. And like Sangura has just shared, some of these things we just used to hear or read about, but now we are doing the theoretical, the practical bit of it. And we are grateful to be facilitators. And just to see lives change and become a role model, there are people who look up to us. So when we perfect our art in our marriage and we have people looking up to us, it's a great honor and we really thank God.
Wow, thank you so much. A big clap, everybody, for this couple who have shared and have now decided to give back to society. So thank you so much, Rebecca and Sam. Thank you. We really appreciate you joining us this morning and sharing about your couples and money journey.
Okay. Wow. It's so exciting to hear what couples and money has done for you. Again, just a recap about couples and money. It's founded by Pastor Murithi Wanjao and his wife, Carol Wanjao. The idea is that it's to help couples create wealth. But the reason you go through the course is so that there's mind shift, there's agreement between the couples, because you don't want to create wealth that destroys families. So that's the purpose of couples and money. Again, if your marriage is on shaky ground, it helps to have talks like today's talk, where then you at least working on your marriage. And today we have an interesting topic, when love runs out. When love runs out. And you know how it is when life happens, you know, children come, or there's an illness, or maybe you've lost a loved one in your journey of marriage, you find that love can dwindle, just start fading off. So how do you restore the love? How do you rekindle the love? And to tell us about that, we have one amazing resource today. He's a relationship coach. He's also a pastor and a founder and CEO of iVow. He's married to Nyawera for how many years? For the last 20 years, and they have three amazing sons. And this is none other than Emmanuel Kashanja. Karibu sana, Emmanuel. We are so excited.
Asante sana. It's good to be here.
An honor to have you here today. And please just Yes, speak to us, tell us how to rekindle love. What happens when love runs out? Do I just pack my bag and go? Or what should we do?
Awesome. Thank you so much, Wangeshi. Thank you so much, Willie. You guys are such fantastic hosts. And thank you for having me, Couples and Money. It's good to be here. Fun fact, what people don't know, Wangeshi is actually my big sister. She's my cousin. So Willie is my brother-in-law. So it's almost like we're in the family business. But yeah, it's good to see you, and it's good to be here. Thank you, every single one of you, for logging in. Wow, there are so many of you who have logged in. That is so amazing. You've woken up early on a Saturday, and that's a beautiful thing. As you heard, my name is Emmanuel Gashanja. I am the founder of an organization called iVow. iVow seeks to preserve the sanctity of marriage within society. I am very passionate about love, passionate about relationships. And so I have dedicated my life towards that end of, hopefully one day when it's all said and done, it will be said of me that there was a man who lived that was passionate about love. And as a result, our society is a much better place and the family unit. Is thriving as a result of that. My wife is Caroline Kariuki Nyawera. She's somewhere here on this call, and we are in two different locations. So we can't do it together, but I think I will represent us very well. At least I hope so. For anybody who may have questions as we go through, please type it in the chat, and we will be sure to respond to it later. I'm going to try and keep this conversation a little bit shorter, just so that I can honor the time, and then so that we can also do a question answer and also maybe just a prayer at the end. Awesome. As Wangeshi said, we are talking about when the wine runs out, and basically we are just talking about, when you feel like love is lost. Marriage is a gift from God, and it's a beautiful thing. And somehow, for the most part, most of us look forward to it. It's almost like a rite of passage in life. And it being a rite of passage, we all desire to get to it at some point. And even if we don't desire to get to it, there's pressure from society asking us, niaje mze, niaje, when are you bringing for us someone to the to the home? So it's something that we all, feel that we should go through at some point. Most of us on this call are married, at least I believe so. And if not married, you're in a relationship, whether it's living together, but you're in a relationship. And it's good to see all of you who are in a relationship here. Now, when you think about marriage, and the love running out, you can't help but wonder, what happened? Well, how were we duped? Because the truth is, we all have seen the movies, we all have read the storybooks of the happily ever after. We all desire for this happily ever after. It's so interesting when I do premarital classes, I see here people saying, I can't believe that will be us, that won't be us. And we all want to believe that our story will be different. And we all go through this stage, the dream phase. I like calling it the marketing stage, where, we are saying all these sweet somethings and doing all these things and pretty much marketing ourselves to this person. And we are doing everything in our attempt of getting them into this place where they admit or commit to living with us together for life. Now, I always enjoy watching people, you know, dating each other and courting each other. It's such a beautiful stage. But something happens when we say, I do. It's like Amesha in gearbox. They're not going anywhere. So we tend to just kind of relax and exhale and say, whew, now that hard work, I don't have to do it anymore. And we get into what I call our exhale status, our default setting. And then this is when the real this person begins to show. And you know, I get people now post I do coming for marriage counseling, and they'll always say, hey, he's changed. She has changed so much. I mean, she's a different person before she used to, before he used to. And then I look at them and I just say, hey, you know what? No, they did not change. This is who they really were. In the marketing phase, they couldn't show you this side. Otherwise, you would not say yes. So now you have to learn to deal with it. And as you're dealing with this, you know, there'll be lots of frustration, lots of conflict. And you'll sort of kind of get jaded. Huh? And then this is where, you know, feelings begin to disappear. And then we feel like, you know, I'm falling out of love with this person. The truth is, what we're never taught, what we're never prepared for, and even when we are told, we don't fathom it until we get into it, is that marriage is work. Marriage is work. And it's constant work from the moment you wake up. Every day, and as you wake up, you have to purpose to do some things so that you know you can keep it running, you can keep it going, you can keep it alive and thriving. But we don't know that. We assume that it was enough to say I do, and then now we will just coast, and it'll be automatic, and you know, we will truly live happily ever after. But the truth is, not long after I do, I always say between 1 and 2 years, even the feelings, you know, those two bubbly feelings, those butterflies that you felt in your stomach, they disappear. And then we feel like the wine has run out and we don't know what to do. And today that's what we want to address. That's what we want to talk about. And we're going to talk about, we're going to draw our lessons from scripture. There's a scripture here that we have read a couple of times, and it's been shared at one or two weddings that I've attended in the past. And I thought it was a powerful scripture, and I'm going to read it for us. And it comes from John chapter 2, from verse 1 to 10. And this is what it says. It says, on the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no more wine. Woman, why do you involve me? Hey, Jesus, but now, can you call mother woman? Anyway, that's a story for another day. Woman, why do you involve me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet. They did so. And the master of the banquet tasted the water and had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you saved the best till now. Wow. This is a story that is recorded in John, and this is a story of, it was Jesus' first miracle that he performed. And here we see that, you know, Jesus had been invited into a wedding, and at the wedding, you know, the wine ran out, and the wine was, of course, you know, as in every sherehe, is normally the main thing other than the food and whatever we are celebrating. So the wine had run out, and it was going to be something that was going to be very embarrassing for this family at this wedding. So, you know, the Jesus' mother decides, hey, let's do something about it. We can't go by, but I have a son who can do something about it. So the son, you know, is not ready to do something about it, but she just goes ahead and gives a command and says, hey, guys, he's going to tell you something, you do something about it. And so this is actually a very powerful, you know, story. So there are three things I see in this portion of scripture. The first one is invite Jesus into your marriage. In verse 1 and 2, it says, on the third day, you know, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. The groom had prepared and done his best job. He tried, you know, to deal with all the details. You know, he had pangered this sherehe to, you know, to the core, but he did it in his own human power, human strength, and with the resources that he had. But we see here that it was not enough. So luckily for him, he had done a very important thing, and this is invite Jesus, who is the Son of God, who is God, into his at his wedding. And Jesus was able to do a miracle at his wedding. So the first thing I'm inviting you guys to do is to invite Jesus into your marriage. Try moving closer to him. Allow him to be part of your relationship. In fact, there's this thing that we talk about in the Ndoa book, in the Ndoa manual. Ndoa is a book that Pastor Murethi and Pastor Carol co-authored. And it's used for premarital, and it's used for marriage and rich. And in one of the weeks, I believe it's week 7, it talks about the marriage triangle, where in the triangle, the top of the triangle right here is where God is. And we are at either the two other corners. And it says that in order for us to draw closer to each other, it is important for us to draw closer to God. And as we draw closer to God, we draw closer to each other. And the reason we do this is because, one, God is the author of marriage. God is the one who created this thing. He is the one who understands and knows what this thing is about. So in us getting closer to him, we are getting closer to his will and to his purpose for our lives. The second thing is, I see here, is do whatever he tells you. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. I'm not sure what the servants must have been thinking, you know, when Jesus asked them to fill those jars. And it says there that the jars were used for washing, you know, stuff. And they carried about 20 to 30 gallons of water. But I'm not sure what they were thinking when this guy told them, fill these jars with water. And those jars were pretty big. 20 to 30 gallons is not small. It's pretty huge. So they must have been thinking, this guy is crazy. We need wine, and he's telling us to put water into these jars. And here Christ is asking them to do something totally unrelated, totally illogical, something that feels like it's a total waste of time. And I can't imagine what they were thinking and what they were, you know, perceiving, you know, at this moment. But luckily for them, in obedience, they did it. Now, here's what's interesting when I think about this. When I think about this, I think about how in my life, a lot of things that the Bible says goes against the way our worldview is set up, the way we look at life. You know, just think about it. When somebody, you know, there's these terms that we currently use quite a bit and we like to throw around. We talk about emotional abuse, you know, things like that. And God's word tells us something that is, it feels contrary to what we feel, what we think, what we want to do, you know, because God's word tells us to love, it tells us to forgive, it tells us to submit, it tells us to accept one another. All these things feel very, very illogical. In fact, when we think of love, when you and I think of love, you know, love is, you know, holding hands, you know, and hoping our hearts will skip a beat, you know. Love is sitting close together and watching a sunset, or walking by the beach together. Love is gazing tenderly into each other's eyes, or as one person put it, and listen to this carefully, because this really tripped me out when I saw this some time back. You know, love is a feeling you feel when you feel that you are about to feel a feeling that you've never felt before. What does that even mean? But isn't it true? So when we think about it and the way we look at love, these are the ways that the world has defined love, and yet when the feeling, which is very fleeting, runs out, we feel like we're fallen out of love. Yet we made a covenant and a commitment to be with this person till death. But the Bible's definition of love is quite different. It tells us love is patient. Let me tell you, that's the most unromantic thing ever. And I typically tell every person that I meet who I have the opportunity to talk about this thing called marriage and love, and especially when patience is mentioned, the person, the husband, the wife that you are hoping for is a good 20 to 25 years away. They have to grow into that role. I'm sure somebody over there must have made a face and said, eh, ati what? And guys, this is so real, because the truth is you were not built to be in that role, and you have to work yourself and grow yourself into that role. And then just think about it. Different seasons come, different you come, and you have to keep adjusting to this person. So your spouse is a good 20 to 25, and they have to grow and learn a lot about you. Love is patient. Now imagine, you know, your partner has all those annoying habits, and I could mention a bunch of them. You know, they don't put the dishes away. They don't close the cupboards. They don't clean put the bed back. You know, when they get up, they wait for you, you know, to come and fix the bed. They leave the toilet seat up. You know, all these annoying things. They are late. They are doing their makeup, and we are supposed to have been gone already. They don't feel like cooking, yet it is a need that you desired to be met. They do all these things, and it's frustrating. And you have to be patient. You have to choose patience so that they can grow into their role. It says love is kind. You have to be kind to this person. Let me ask you, when your guy, when your dude, and this is actually a common problem I'm seeing nowadays, where men, you know, say they are coming back in 5 minutes, at 4 a.m. is when they're strolling into the house in time just to shower, to shower, eat breakfast, and then go back to work. And you have to choose. The Bible tells you love is a choice. Love is an action. Love is you choosing to be kind to this person, even when they're offending you. It says love does not envy. It's not rude. I mean, just picture when somebody has been upset with you and you just want to unleash that sarcasm, you know, just so that you can let them know how you feel about them. It says love is not self-seeking. It means love is selfless. You're constantly thinking about the other person and not yourself. So you're putting their interests above yours. In fact, Paul says that in Philippians 3, or rather Philippians 2, sorry, about verse 5. He talks about how it is important for us in our relationships to put the interests of our partners above our own interests. So who's looking out for me? Who's looking out for my needs? Who's looking out for my wants and my desires? We hope it's the other person, but if they're not tuned in and you're locked into this marriage, then what happens? Love is not easily angered. Now, this person has been going out, coming at CG, what time? This person is doing all sorts of things, and it tells you, do not be angry. Man, this is just very illogical. It tells us it keeps no record of wrongs. By the way, for people like me who have a fantastic memory, I really struggle with this because I just want to remind you, this is where we come from. This is the context, you know. This is the context of why we are here and why I'm telling you and why we are addressing this. The truth is, love and God's instructions are very, very illogical. But here, Mary is telling them, do what he says. And Jesus does something that is very illogical. The third thing is that God can make something out of what you have. When we go back to the passage, Jesus could have easily created wine out of thin air. He could easily have gone and done, like, you know, some other random stuff. But he looked and he saw the jars. He told them to fill those jars. And as they filled those jars, what happened is that the wine was formed. Throughout the Bible, we see Jesus doing things like this. Whether it was a little boy who had, you know, 5 loaves and 2 fish, whether it was somebody who just came with faith and he used that faith and told him, your faith has made you well. Or whether it was a blind man who's, you know, he picked the dirt out of the earth, spit on it and put it on his eyes and then washed it off. And this guy began to see. The truth is that if you trust, if you invite Jesus into your heart, if you allow him to speak into your life and listen to his instructions, he will use what you have, the very thing that you have in your lives, and he can turn your situation around. He can fill that wine back up, and it will even be better wine, newer wine, tastier wine, richer wine than the one that was there before, just like he did for this couple, at the wedding. Now, allow me to share a personal story. My wife and I got married 20 years ago. And it was a beautiful thing when we got married. It was true love. It was true love. And we courted for a very short time just because, hey, we fell hard for each other. So we meet in January. And by the next year, March, we're going walking down the aisle and saying, I do. Once we got married, life happened. And somehow, you know, we fell into the rut that we everybody falls into. And there was so much frustration within our relationship, those conflict. We entered into something we call the drama stage. And in this drama stage, you know, we're just like, ah, maybe I blundered. Maybe this was the wrong person. And I remember, you know, praying to God. And I would pray to God. In fact, one day, me being my spirit self, well, I prayed almost a whole night. I started at 10 p.m. and I just started praying. And I think I was just passionate. 4 a.m., I'm still there praying in the sitting room, praying for this daughter of Eve, that the Lord would come and speak to daughter of Eve, you know, who is in my life. And I'll never forget this, the instructions that I felt that God was saying. You know, God told me that the issue was not my wife. So he spoke it to me in a still small voice. You know that thing you feel, you have a sense. I sense this. So I had that sensing and I ignored it. I said, this is from the devil. You know, me, I'm not the issue. The issue is this woman. The daughter of Eve is the issue. And then another pastor and a mentor, you know, was just like, you know, they preached a sermon which to that effect, you know, sometimes the problem is not your person. The problem is you. And I was just like, ah, this one is coinciding with that devil that was speaking in me. Then I went to another place and you know how you can be online and you're watching, you know, a YouTube video. And that person was speaking that day. I was like, okay, sawa, nimesikia. And I said, then what can I do? And I remember I'd just watched this movie a year back. Actually, no, a few months before that. And this movie was called Fireproof. And in that movie, there was a love dare challenge where you go through the attributes of love for 40 days. And in 40 days, you take on one of the attributes of love and begin to implement it in your life. So for me, I decided to do it. Let me not do it in 40 days. Let me do it in 40 weeks to give myself an opportunity to at least you know, work on each attribute per week. So week one, you read about love, the first attribute, love is patient. You read what it says, then you say a prayer, then it tells you, this week now go and be patient with your partner. Well, my friends, this is when I think, I saw horns in my wife. I think I saw horns in my wife. Because I think the devil came in her. And I think it was that way because I was trying to do something. So I just felt like the devil will throw everything and anything in order to test you. That week, I don't remember what happened. Hey, but I was just, it was testing my patience like crazy. Then Sunday comes, I read the next one, love is kind. And I kept doing that for 40 weeks. And I remember at the end of 40 weeks, first of all, I've never been more tired than I was at that moment because it was just emotionally, spiritually, and also physically draining. At the end of the 40 weeks, I was a totally new man. And I remember how I related with my wife was very different from what I had done before. And in my relation to her, I remember she could even notice that, hey, this guy is a new man. This guy has changed. Something has changed. And I remember she used to respond to me differently. And good people, this is me just ending the session. You know, doing that love dare challenge, it really changed my life. And it changed my life because one, at some point, in spite of the fact that I'd been a Christian and served in church and all that, Christ was in my heart, but Christ was not in my marriage. So I had to invite him into my marriage. And this is a good 10 years to 11 years into marriage. So I invite him into marriage. And then I ask him for his instructions. And he began to speak to me. What he told me went contrary to what, you know, we would think. In fact, the phrases we use nowadays and the things and the sentiments that we share nowadays is, it's never that serious. you can find another person. There's another fish in the sea. But doing that instruction, following God's instruction and allowing him to use whatever it is that I had at that time, it changed my life, my marriage. So good people, I just want to challenge us and I just want to just encourage us that sometimes we feel like, and this is spoken a lot, that Christianity and the Bible is irrelevant. I'm a living testimony that it is very real. I'm a living testimony that this actually does change your marriage. I don't think we would have been married today, but we can celebrate 20 years because we opted to invite Jesus, follow his instructions, and then, you know, allow him to use whatever we had to change our relationship.
Wow. Wow. Amazing. What a profound lesson right there. What did you people hear? How do you, the jars are empty, that's what I heard. What do you do with empty jars in a relationship?
Yeah, Pastor G, I think you're over spiritualizing this issue because, you know, as I was listening to you, I was like, we've actually been married 22 years.
Yeah.
So I was trying to remember
40 days challenge.
Feelings. Feelings. We used to have feelings.
Yeah.
I think we still do.
I think they faded. Yeah.
Food for thought, man. Really, really. Actually, when those feelings run out, what holds the marriage together? I think that's the bottom line.
Mm-hmm.
And you really brought it out in that verse. That thing called love is not a feeling. So it is patience. It is kindness. It does not envy. You know, it's a big challenge. I mean, that's very profound what you've shared.
And this thing about kindness, you know, when you're upset with somebody, you don't want to throw their food at them. You don't want to serve gracefully.
Yeah.
So how do you incorporate kindness when you're upset? I'm just curious. There's a question there. What causes the love to run out for couples? Please post your answers there. And then also ask questions.
Yeah. If you have any questions for Pastor G, please go ahead and post them so that we can answer.
And how do you feel this jazz, like practically?
What a spirituality. What is
practically? How do I practically?
Let's get your reaction, Pastor G, on that question.
So how you do it practically is intentional acts. There's this thing we talk about, a social, emotional, spiritual intimacies. Are the different kinds of intimacies. For example, for my wife and I, we try every single day to walk with each other in the evening. And this evening walk is not necessarily for burning calories. It works as for burning calories, but really it's a moment for us to just catch up and talk and to chat and to just bond with each other. And let me tell you, those moments are just some of the best moments that we have. Now, context is contrary to popular belief, I do not talk much. I am one of those very silent people. In fact, it frustrates the mess out of my wife. She's just like, hey, and you say something, just say something. How are you feeling? So one of the things I've had to do is teach myself that on this walk, that I have to have content to share with her. So that's one of the things that we do. Getting into each other's interests, what does she like? What does she love? And for her, what do I like? What do I love? And how can she connect with that? So those are some of the practical things that we can do. And then when it comes to emotional intimacy, is how can we go from just courtesy conversations to conversations where you're sharing your deepest fears and your deepest, wildest dreams? And how can we create a safe space for us to be able to share that? However ridiculous or however, you know, practical it is. And we have that space. We have become friends. We do a lot of things, you know, together, laugh together. We go for bowling. We go watch movies. Just, you know, simple things so that, you know, she's my best friend and I'm her best friend. And what I like to say, and I think I said it in the last time I spoke here, is we did not date each other to marry each other. We married each other so that we can date each other for the rest of our lives. So what does that look like for you? What does that look like for you? And whatever it looks like for you, do it. If you're people for road trips, go on road trips. We try to save every once in a while and go out of town. Even if it is just here to Meru, we don't have to go to Mombasa or to Dubai or to Paris or CG. We go to Meru, you know, and stay at Alba Hotel. We save for Alba Hotel. And we go to Alba Hotel. We kunywa a little kachai and samosas. And then we come back to Nairobi. But it's that time that we spend with each other. On dates, there are times, I remember there was a time we went to Windsor Hotel. It sounds like a really fancy place, but you know what we ordered? We ordered one ice cream and we got two spoons. And then we just ate. Of course, I had the least amount, but it was the company that was very important. And the fact that we're just sitting, overlooking those gris, you know, lawns. So it's just simple things like that. You don't have to break the bank. It's just, what can you do with each other so that you're bonding with each other?
Well, thanks for sharing those profound tips. good tips, good reminders for some of us. We have some reactions. So from Rebecca, she's saying, getting married saved not only your life, I'm not sure what that means. Get your marriage saved, not only your life. Wow, okay, that's interesting. Then Sylvester and Zomo, we invite Jesus into our marriage, follow and do whatever Jesus instructs you to do, and that Jesus can use whatever you have. Men have been challenged. I had Jesus in heart, but I had not invited him in my marriage. We have purpose to invite Jesus in every single act of our marriage. Wow. That's a very good take out, Sylvester and Rebecca. We really appreciate.
And then you can see the Ishimwes.
Ishimwes.
I'm pronouncing that right, Elaine. They're actually doing the lab there, which is, I don't know what it is. It's a challenge.
Yeah, there's a book on it. There's actually a book.
Okay.
And it's a challenge that you get to do. It just has different attributes of love that you can begin to apply in your life. Hey, it is not for the faint of heart.
Okay, I think that's by Cynthia Otieno. Is it?
No. That one is, I don't remember who the authors is. Maybe Elaine and can tell us.
Okay, can look out for that book check online and get to see it. Is there any other comment? before, we don't want to lock you out. All right. So what I've heard is that we need to fill our jars. We need to start going for a walk in the evening, maybe try.
Somebody saying you can turn water into wine.
You can turn water into wine.
So let me interpret that. So you're saying the love that is missing between the two of you is the water. So it can be turned into wine.
Yeah, it means it's there is hope. And leverage on that hope, do something. You cannot do the same thing and expect different results. So you want to try something out so that there's a different result. And while we are thinking about that, we want to just invite you to, these kind of events happen every first Saturday of the month. So we will have another event like this on the 5th of November, which is the first Saturday of the next month. And we have, you know, we want to inspire marriages. We want to marriages that are thriving, and we are giving open days where you can just come and listen to these kind of things. Can you tell us a little bit about Couples and Money? Is there a class?
So this particular event is basically for the Couples and Money community and anybody else who's willing to basically just get to hear about couples and money. But it also, we're supposed to just also encourage one another as couples and enrich each other's marriages. And we really appreciate today's topic. It has really brought a lot of food for thought. We'll have a similar event to this on the, actually we have an event just like this every first Saturday of the month. So our next event will be on the 5th of November. And you are invited, and please invite your friends as well. As we stated earlier on, the Couples and Money is a 10-week course, which is done basically to just help couples get a better understanding of money and help them increase their knowledge in this area. We invite you to join us if you need to join. If you've not done Couples and Money and want more information, our admin will post their number in the chat, and then you can get to engage. As stated, we hope to have a similar event to this on the first of Saturday of each month, and this is open to everyone, not just people who are in Couples and Money. But each and every person, because it's supposed to help enrich our marriages.
Okay. Yeah. So we do have a current class ongoing for Couples and Money. And the next class is in January. You want to plan your finances. Don't eat all your Christmas. Don't party too much. Invest in your marriage. Remember, the community is affected by your marriage decisions. Yeah. And keeping it healthy and prioritizing building healthy families is instrumental to building strong, productive nation. So please, there's a number there. You can liaise with Dorcas Washuka, and she'd be able to help you to log in or to save your spot for January. So that's all for today. We are so excited. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's been such an honor to be with you. We are the Kanyakis, and we have been your hosts and MCs, Asanteni Sana. And so please have a fantastic Saturday and look for ways to fill your jars.
Yeah, just to close, it would be actually be good if you could have Pastor G just pray for all the couples here, and that God will fill your jars.
Yeah.
All right, let's pray. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you for this time that you've given us to just engage with each other and engage in truths that talk about what you can do for us, oh God. In our own power, in our own might, in our own strength, Lord, we are very wanting, oh God. And we are weak compared to you, oh God. So, Father in heaven, I pray that each one of us will truly not just invite you into our hearts, but invite you into our relationships, into our marriage, and allow you to begin to speak into it, oh God. And Father, I pray that as you speak into it, that we will be obedient to listen and to hear what you're saying for us, O God. And that, Father, as we begin to apply those things, that, Lord, we will begin to see renewed and restored and refilled jars, and that our wine, Lord, will be even better than it was before. So, Father in heaven, I pray that your Spirit will help us in this, O God, and that you will guide us in this. I pray for each couple that has come here, O God. Be with them, protect them, watch over them, and bless them as they continue to love each other, as they continue to figure out this love thing with each other. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Emmanuel. We are so grateful, honored to have you. And thank you for the tips. We'll practice.
Please do. I will make sure I ask the kids if daddy and mommy are walking.
We appreciate. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Have a wonderful rest of day and rest of weekend and a wonderful week ahead. God bless everyone and enjoy the rest of the day.
Okay, somebody.
Thank you.